Okay, Moments to Remember, it's there, you have
okay.
it. Give me those two.
All right. Here's the Moments to Remember. She's got the old original music for that stuff, and it is just falling apart. This one's a little better shape.
I'm 88 years old. I was born in 1923. Chisholm, Minnesota.
Wow.
The best town in the whole world. No, my twin sister was born then.
We will have these moments to remember. The quiet walks, the noisy fun, the ballroom prize we almost won. We will have these moments to remember.
While I was singing, I was professor of singing and speech at Augustana College in Sioux Falls. I went to college and I learned how. I took a lot of voice lessons. Piano, I'm not very good at the piano.
It's too winter and the present disappears. The laughter we were glad to share.
Sang with the Minneapolis Opera, San Francisco Opera. On Sioux Falls, I sang in every opera and play and playhouse and play and musical they ever did. I did a lot of musicals, like King and I, Sound of Music. I don't know, name them.
When all other days and other nights will find us gone.
Most famous when I sang with Frank Sinatra. That was in California. I was in the Navy and I was a vocalist with the Navy band. And we were singing and then it was time to get off and let Tommy Dorsey get on. So I ran and somebody grabbed me and said, "Hey little girl, where are you going?" And I looked up, oh my God, it was Frank Sinatra. And I said, "Bad, bad, bad. It's your turn." "No, little girl, it's our turn. Do you know now is the hour?" And I said, "Yes." "All right, come on. I'll sing the melody. You sing the harmony." Put his arms around me and we went on stage and I was in shock. Absolute shock. I used to be able to sing. I'm just very self-conscious now. That's why this is going to be the last one. But oh, it's so nice to get out of that place I live in.
She interviewed John F. Kennedy.
Yep.
I saw her on a video dancing with Lawrence Welk.
Well, that was in when I had my television show.
She was an anchor woman in Sioux Falls, South Dakota for many years, right?
20.
20?
Mm-hmm.
With her husband as co-anchor.
Cool. Oh, I have to change glasses.
Okay. So who are you exactly, real quick?
Who am I?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Like your name?
Eugenia.
Oh, hi.
Eugenia, what's your name?
Laverne.
Laverne, hi.
Oh, yes, oh, say, oh,
Well, it was the news. The news.
News hour, right?
The news. And then I had a show of my own where I interviewed people. Oh, I had an exciting life till I came here.
Behind you.
Really?
Twin sister, but she's 5 inches taller than I am. But she's beautiful. No, she sings, but she sings tenor. And I sing coloratura. Coloratura is the highest you can sing.
You know, they look at what's good and they ignore what isn't perfect. Mm-hmm. And they're probably going, I can't believe she has the guts to get up there. I would never do that. You know, that's how I'm always.
Well, yeah.
Whenever I go see, and plus you're wonderful. So whenever I see anybody performing, I'm always thinking, there's no way anybody could save me.
This is my life.
Yeah, and that's why you're going to be so good.
So did I. So did I. Hunter College, yeah. And then I went to Milledgeville.
What?
Then I went to Milledgeville.
I went to Farragut, Idaho.
Oh. Who else? Women. Where were you stationed?
Washington, D.C.
Oh, wow. Where were you stationed? Oh, I thought she. Who else raised their hands? Who else raised their hands? Women. Any men stationed in California? Oh, geez. I'm trying to find some people that I used to be in the Navy with, and I can't. Will I have to be dead before I do that? Huh?
You're too young.
No, I was in the Navy.
So what? Were you in the Navy during World War II?
Yes.
Oh.
1942.
Oh.
Do I look young?
Do I look young? That's nice. All right, we're going to talk about Greatest Generation, which is what we are. How many of you are in the 80s? 80s. How many of you are in the 80s?
Your 80s,
yeah. Yes, I'm in the 80s.
Oh! You just think you're a kid.
Let's start with the first song, Mark.
that is the way our conversation goes, doesn't it? Those of us who are in our 80s or older, or I suppose 70s. Not 70s, not old. We are the product of the 40s. We are the greatest generation. Have you read Tom Brokaw's The Greatest Generation? Have you read that book? Oh, you've got to read it. It's all about the 40s. And it's a wonderful book. And it's kind of nice, and I guess I feel kind of proud that somebody wrote a book about me. But I'm sure some of you had the same experiences that I have. So let me start and tell you. Franklin Delano Roosevelt, who became president in 1933, died in 1945. He accomplished so much. He came to empathize with the poor and the underprivileged. The New Deal and World War II brought new expectations to millions of people. Franklin Delano Roosevelt was a child of fortune, but he left a legacy that enriched every American. He challenged Americans to greatness. Franklin Delano Roosevelt emerged as the greatest political leader of his age. And Eleanor Roosevelt, his wife, her public activities broke the mold for first ladies and for women. The 40s. We were a memorable generation. 30 million war babies were born between 1942 and 1950. Musicals were sprouting all over Broadway, South Pacific, Oklahoma, Carousel, Annie Get Your Gun, The King and I, Sound of Music, and others, and Judy Garland thrilled us with her signature song, Over the Rainbow. What a decade. We had so many labels, didn't we? We were the Saddle Shoes generation. We were the Jitterbug generation. Oh, didn't we dance? I miss dancing. Do you have dancing here? Don't you have dancing? But we don't either, darn it. But we were the Bobby Sox generation. And we were the big band generation. Remember Glenn Miller and A String of Pearls? Da, 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 da. Oh, I loved that song. I loved it. I loved it. On December 18th, however, and this is where starts the horror of the 40s, the Holocaust started in June 1943. And there are a lot of things about the 40s that we cannot forget. Do any of you remember Elie Wiesel? Mm-hmm. Do any of you remember Elie Wiesel? Who?
Vaguely.
Oh, vaguely, okay. I used to have a television show, and I interviewed Elie Wiesel. He is a survivor of the Holocaust. And when he walked in the room, he looked so haunted. Eyes were, he was just haunted. He was a survivor of the Holocaust. He's still alive. He's in New York. He's gotten awards. He's a professor. He does everything. And so he talked to me, and we had a very good interview. And I was also teaching at Augustana College. So I asked him if he would come and talk to my class. Well, that depends. What are you studying? Well, we're studying listening. I said, good. Everybody's got to listen. They've got to listen to what we have to say about the Holocaust and what the Germans did to us, and they have to pass it on. They have to listen. So they came to my class, and my class didn't know who he was, but I'm glad none of them said anything. But the one thing he said that I will always, always remember, I asked him, I said, Mr. Wiesel, didn't you say, where is God? During that whole time of the Holocaust, he said, of course we all said, where is God? And where is God? He's right with us. Right with us. And then Mr. Wiesel said, you have to remember one thing. There are no answers, only questions. And he's right about so many things. There are no answers, only questions. The 40s teenager wanted to be like everybody else, I remember. Nothing has changed. The girls looked like peas in the pod. Remember, we wore blue jeans and white shirts, over the blue jeans. Oh, I hope you remember that. And of course, with the saddle shoes and the penny loafers. Remember the penny loafers? The zoot suit was something else. Did anybody here wear a zoot suit? Oh, I'm sorry. You know what the zoot suit was? Okay.
No.
Well, no? Well, you're too young.
I wanna know.
The jukebox was a hit. Put another nickel in.
The zoot suits had big shoulders and cut all the way down. Like a real comical tuxedo, and they put the chains on the vest. You saw the movie with Jim Carrey, was it?
I don't know.
Where in the zoot suit?
How do you remember?
Well, I'm into Latino.
Oh, okay. and we sang, remember, don't sit under the apple tree with anybody else but me. Mary's the oats and knows the oats and then the lamb's the hiney. The jukebox was a hit. Put another nickel in the Nickelodeon. And songs were sold by the hundreds. As soon as they appeared on the charts. Dancing was the thing. Don't you remember how we danced? Oh my, we had proms and we danced. And I still love to dance. Jukebox Saturday night, remember? Then on October 23rd, a phenomenon happened. Frank Sinatra stepped on the stage of the Paramount Theater in New York, and the King of Swoon was born. He didn't necessarily have a beautiful voice, but he was young and shy, and he knew how to communicate with the song. Bobby Soxers felt they knew him, and he belonged to us. The war began on December 7th, 1941, 70 years ago, with an attack on Pearl Harbor. Yesterday, a day that will live in infamy. Do you remember those words from Franklin Delano Roosevelt? He announced to the world that the United States was at war. And where were you when he made that famous speech? I was in college. We all had to gather in an auditorium, and he told us all. But we couldn't believe it. The United States at war? Wait, that can't happen. But it did. 70 years ago, and on December 8th, the United States and Britain declared war on Japan. December 7th, Germany declared war on the United States. December 19th, Hitler took complete command of the German army. Immediately, life changed. Men were called to join the service. Rationing began. Everything was rationed. Food stamps, gas stamps. Danny had 3 grocery stores. He suddenly couldn't get merchandise. Sugar, coffee, pineapple, among other things, were rationed. And my father had 3 grocery stores, and he had to close 2. He couldn't get merchandise, and of course he couldn't get anybody to help because they were all in the services. So my sister and I delivered the groceries and we did all the merchandising and selling. We learned a lot. And on Sundays, we sat at the dining room table and we counted all the stamps. Red stamps for meat, fish, cheese, and dairy products. Blue stamps for vegetables, canned fruit, and other products. Each stamp was worth a number of points. Gasoline was rationed. The 35-mile-an-hour speed limit was allowed. Long stickers were given out according to how much or where you drove your vehicle. Civilians collected used rubber, old tires, garden hoses, rubber gloves. These items were recycled and remolded. June 20th of 1961, John Kennedy famously appealed to us in this statement, "Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country." We could have said that in the 40s. We could have. My twin sister and I joined the Navy in 1943. We had finished 2 years of college and had never been apart. Being twins and best friends, we did everything together. So we both joined the Navy. But she went to the West Coast and I went to the West Coast. How could they do that to us? But they did. We never served together. My mother's friends criticized her, and she said, horrible things are going to happen to us if we join the Navy with all those men. And my mother said, never mind. I raise my girls to be good girls. And my father said, you darn right. So you just leave my girls alone. We raise them to be good kids. And I would recommend being the services to anyone. For women, men had a fight. For women, we learned so much. It was such a wonderful experience. Do you remember the stars in the windows?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And what were the gold? There were four stars. They were for men who were in the service. And there was one star that was gold. And what was that?
They were killed.
Yeah. The gold star meant that somebody in that family was killed. My brother Michael, who joined the Navy, said that many young kids looked on their war experiences and adventures. They were young, and of course, immortal. They traveled, they got new clothes, met new people, made new lives. Soon these friends began to get killed, and it wasn't long because my brother and his friends realized that this war is real. The whole world changed. We couldn't be isolated anymore. Women took men's jobs. Remember Rosie the Riveter? Anybody here, Rosie the Riveter?
Yeah.
Oh, most of us were. This made the country realize that women could do anything they wanted. Right? It took a long time, but look what evolved. Women replaced men in every kind of job there was. They worked in factories. They worked in iron mines. I come from the Iron Range in Minnesota.
Minnesota.
Huh?
Hibbing, Minnesota.
Yes! Oh, you don't. Really?
Yeah.
Are you from Hibbing? Oh. You're the first person I've ever met from Northern Minnesota.
I'm not from Northern Minnesota. I'm from Minneapolis.
Oh, well, but you know Northern Minnesota. Oh, and you know the iron ore mines in Northern Minnesota? Well, they were depleted. Trains came from Michigan and all over to get the high-grade iron ore so they could make munitions. War trains came and just took everything away. The Iron Range became devastated. No iron ore was left to be mined. A lot of industries converted to war products using our precious iron ore. And many other changes came about. Do you remember saving scrap iron? No cars, air raid drills. Our lives changed overnight. No nylons for women. So what did we do?
Pain.
Huh?
Pain and relief.
How come a man has to say that?
We had four sisters.
Huh?
Four sisters.
Oh, we had four sisters. Yes, we bought leg makeup, yeah, and we put it on our legs because we couldn't. There was nothing. We couldn't buy silk stockings. But there were moments of joy. Bob Hope went overseas with his lovely starlets. Did any of you hear Bob Hope?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Did you? Ah, oh, that's nice. Carpools, canteens. Bill Malden drew cartoons about every phase of Army life. Maybe I can be funny afterwards, he said, but anybody who has seen this war can be cute about it while it's going on. The only way I can try to be a little funny is to make something of the humorous situations which come up, even when you don't think life could be more miserable. His cartoons did brighten us. Being the war generation, we sang war songs. We had many songs reminding us of how it would be when the war was over. Two American songwriters wrote, and I couldn't find the music. If any of you have the music to White Cliffs of Dover, tell me. I want some. They looked to better days when bombs over London would be replaced by bluebirds, and they wrote the White Cliffs of Dover. Mark looked for it. I looked for it. We couldn't find it. And it is the most touching song to come out of the war. Miriam, do you have it?
No, but I'm writing it down.
Oh, good. Oh, you're a good kid. One night at the USO, our band had just finished playing, and we were leaving the stage to prepare for Tommy Dorsey's band. I ran off the stage and ran into somebody who grabbed me and said, "Hey, little one." Yeah, I was really little then. "Oh, there, little girl, where are you going?" I looked at him and, oh my God, it was Frank Sinatra. And I said, it's your turn to go on. "No, little girl, it's our turn to go on." He said, "Do you know the song, Now Is the Hour?" "Yeah." "All right, I'll sing the melody and you sing the harmony." He put his arms around me and we went on the stage and I was in shock. Can you imagine singing with Frank Sinatra? Well, I couldn't. But you know what? I have my own Frank Sinatra. And we are going to sing the song that Frank Sinatra and I sang. It was, what's the name of it? Now Is the Hour. He asked me if I knew it. And I said, yes. And he said, "I'll sing the melody and you sing the harmony." So, sweetie over here and I will sing it. Music would brighten the lives of the men and the women in uniform. Our boys, and they were boys, fought and died so that you and I can enjoy freedom to speak out. And speak out we must. My relatives in Yugoslavia never had the freedom of speech. They didn't dare speak out for fear they would either disappear or be thrown into prison. I wish I could have given them my freedom, but I can't. But you and I can use this freedom to pass on our memories and experiences so present and future generations will know that their precious liberties were hard won. There were plenty of tears and fears during this great war. After the Japanese struck Pearl Harbor, the Americans reacted with a gut impulse for revenge. Suddenly, the American Japanese was refused everything. Milkmen refused to deliver milk. Gasoline stations refused to let them have gas. And in barber shops, get this, there was a sign, "Japs shaved. Not responsible for accidents." The Japs were thrown out in quickly made barracks. In other words, they were thrown into prison. They were really internment camps, and they ran for 4 years. After the war, they were ready to step back into regular lives. Where shall we go? What shall we do? Many, including me, believe that this never should have happened, but so much should never have happened. Then came the end of the war. There were many victories, but but at a heavy cost. In 1945, and a return to civilian life, we wanted to get out of our service uniforms, our Rosie the Riveter outfits, and start a new free life. We wore party dresses, and I saved mine. We women saved our platform shoes, but unfortunately, I'm not 21 anymore, and I can't wear them. You know, I'm too bad. I tried, I really did. But along with our new life and freedom, we kept memories that will live on and on and on. Let us never forget to pass these memories so present and future generations will know that their precious liberties were hard won. Let us always have these moments to remember. Construction degree, he established super homes. Do any, maybe some of you even know those? The GI Bill made such a difference. It invested in our servicemen and women. Many went to college. New cars were made. Industries flourished. And maybe some of you benefited from the GI Bill. I know many who did. I did. I finished my college with money from the service. And you know, that was wonderful. My father had five of us in college at once. And if the Navy would pay for two of us, there were four of us in the Navy. Well, that was really something. Oh. And so that's all I've got to say about the 40s. Any of you, I know that you know a lot. So some of you, you sang the words to one of the songs. You did. You did. Do you have some memories that you can give to us about the greatest generation?
No, but I have a question.
Yes.
Were you on the radio in Sioux Falls, South Dakota?
Yes.
I thought so.
No, I was on the television.
On television, yeah.
Did you live in Sioux Falls?
I'm from Garrison.
Oh, yeah, I had a television show of my own.
I know you did.
Yeah. Gee, I met two people who know me. Wow. But can any of you any memories, any stories? Yeah, I knew you would.
Well,
wait a minute.
My grandfather came from
Czechai, as we say in Yugoslavian. Czechai.
Okay.
Wait.
My grandfather came from Denmark.
Oh.
And I remember, never got back there after he came to America. But I remember when Hitler overran Europe. He overran a country. The first thing he did was to make the Jews wear a yellow star to easily identify them. Well, he when he came to Denmark, He put out the order, and the king, on down, all of them, all the citizens wore the yellow star.
What?
In union, oh, unity,
oh, I understand,
with the Jews.
Yeah.
They confused the hell out of the Germans, of course. Served them right. My father was German, but that doesn't make any difference. Anyway, he, you know,
that's awesome.
Voiced them. Yeah.
That is awesome. That's wonderful. Anybody else? Oh, there must be somebody who has stories. Yeah. My hippie friend.
Do you remember when you were recruiting an angry brutality?
Can you hear her?
Yeah.
No. Okay.
When we were recruiting that march, do you remember this one? The day I joined the Navy as a recruit for the waves, I gave up all my luxuries and all my latest clothes. I didn't know what I was in for, but I've surely found out. You can get into the Navy, but just try to get out.
Oh. No, I never heard that.
You never heard that. Oh. We marched to that.
Well, I'll be darned. Who else? Come on, you got stories, don't you?
Do you remember that big billboard? Join the Navy.
Oh, yeah.
And
oh,
release a man for sea duty.
Were any of you Rosie the Riveters? Who did men's jobs? You're kidding. I know you've got a story.
Well, not really. My husband was in the Marine Corps, and he was a trumpeter, and he had gone to South Dakota State College, and he was a trumpeter up there. And so he joined the Marine Corps band, and we were sent to Chicago. And then all of a sudden they needed a replacement overseas, and for 4.5 years he was overseas, and I didn't hear a word from him.
You didn't get a word for 4 years?
No.
Oh my God.
I didn't.
Oh my God, that's terrible.
Yeah.
What about email? I don't mean the kind of email on computers. I mean the kind. Remember, you
no.
Remember email, don't you?
Yeah, no. Well, no.
You don't.
But anyway, no, he didn't send out any mail.
Oh.
But I had a brother-in-law who arrived on Saipan, and he let me know that he was there. But then Bill had an operation. He was driving a truck, and he was the first one operated on in Saipan. And then after the war was over, well, then he was in Nagasaki when the A-bomb hit. And needless to say, that was really something. But anyway, yeah.
He got out alive. He got out alive.
Yeah, oh yeah, but he didn't get home until 9 months after the war was over, because he had been to college and he knew how to make water, and he had to go and do that. So it was a long time before he got home, and everybody else was coming home, and here I was.
You went crazy.
Yeah, but I really did.
Whoa.
But everything turned out fine.
You? No, I didn't. Okay, who's got a nice story? Or funny, or awful? Do you have an awful story? Do you have an awful story?
No, I don't.
Do you have a nice story?
Quite a few of my friends served.
You have to use the mic because you've got a soft voice.
I got to go. Quite a few of my friends served in Vietnam. I was in the National Guard. That's why.
Oh, okay. Well, you can tell us something that maybe we never knew. Never, never, never knew.
Should we do a few more tunes? Songs.
I don't know, would they like some?
Why don't you do your Serbian tune?
Where's my folder?
Right there.
I have some with me that they want to sing some Navy songs.
Oh, some Navy songs.
Yeah. Is it my white folder?
Mm-hmm. White folder's right there. Your white folder is right there.
That's my father. He takes care of me. Would you like to sing some songs like the Marine Hymn or the United States Air Force or Coast Guard or Army caissons? Would you like to sing those?
Sure.
Yeah.
I'm on
Anchor's Away. Wait.
Here we go.
I can't find it.
Marines? Yeah, my husband was in the Marines.
Anybody in the Air Force?
Thank you.
young kids. I don't know how much you know about the world, about the greatest generation. Yes, we are the greatest generation. And I don't know, maybe you learned something about this. I hope you never have to go through all this. But you never know. You never know the way the world is going now, right? Well, have a nice day with you. We've enjoyed coming here. Thank you so much.
Thank you.